Nós daremos então início à próxima palestra, que tem como tema a psicologia da regulação. Para tal, convidamos o Dr. Werner de Bon, PhD, professor de finanças e diretor fundador do Dry House Center for Behavioral Finance da DePaul University, Chicago, e um dos instituidores do campo das finanças comportamentais.
Well, good morning, all of you. It's a pleasure to be with you. I've never been in Brazil. It's an interesting experience. I want to thank the organizers, José Alexandro Vasco and Vera Rita in particular, for inviting me to come here. Well, my topic, as you can see, is the psychology of regulation. This is a little bit broader than the narrower topic of this conference, but it's certainly my idea to say a few things about financial regulation and about investor education. I have to say I'm impressed by all these people who, all the regulators I see, who appeal to behavioral science and want to help regulate the financial world. My main message here today is actually one of realism, of humility. Let's be cautious. You know, regulators, I understand they want to intervene, behavioral interventions. But for that to work, first of all, you have to understand behavior. Then, more ambitiously, you have to try to predict what people would do. And then you hope to interfere, obviously for the better. I mean, you want interventions that work. I think we have to be careful at that because we are in danger of a backlash. As you know, regulations come in waves of deregulation and waves of regulation. I understand this is a public that is very favorably inclined towards regulation, and I'm actually with you on that. I just want it to be smart regulation. You know, historically, the question has often been asked, of course, there have always been laws and rules and regulations and institutions and public policy, but historically, very much the question has been asked, in whose interest? It is really a fairly recent phenomenon. I would quote Otto Eduard Leopold von Bismarck, who in the 1980s, in Germany, when you read his speeches at the time, he introduced health insurance, Social Security, some kind of pension plan, unemployment insurance, all with the idea that people would become more attached to the state and would not see the state as the enemy, as something oppressive, but that they would be, that the masses of the people would have an interest in it. Because, you know, regulation has consequences, of course, for the allocation of resources. Just think about the real estate bubble in the United States and in much of Europe. It has distributional consequences. There are always winners and losers. Don't forget that. And of course, it has consequences for the stability of the whole economic system. So the question has to be asked, you know, why regulate? Why meddle? Why meddle in people's lives? I think the basic idea is to protect people from others, from nature, also from themselves. But, you know, today, when you look at the world, as you know, we live in a highly uncertain world. I would describe much of what is going on in Western Europe, like in Italy, and in Britain, and in the United States, as a crisis of authority, a crisis of trust. You know, in Chicago, where I live, people have essentially three feelings. I mean, the public at large. Great anger about the past, what has happened, and a lot of that had to do with regulation. Great anxiety about the future, And with respect to Washington, or I'm sorry to say, people like us, disgust. That's actually, you know, the widely shared feelings out there. So, you know, general thoughts about education, yeah, maybe government is looking out for me, but, you know, the regulations often fail. That's what people see. And they say, oh, it surely employs a lot of people. It's a huge bureaucracy, probably costs a lot of money. And what does it really do? I'm safer, I suppose. I think that is very much the attitudes that are out there. So that idea that we should be careful in what we do to avoid a backlash is the grand thought here of my talk. And now I'm going to go in a bit of detail. There it is. So I'm going to say, ladies and gentlemen, it's a wild world. It's a wild world. I'm going to make a few comments about trust. I've already started that. I'm saying, look, what regulation ultimately is supposed to do is to protect. That might be very ambitious. It's supposed to produce trust, which a market economy needs, you know. I've already introduced my idea that we might, that not just our customers, not just investors might be overconfident. Some of the people who do all the regulating might be overconfident too. I'm just going to illustrate these ideas with a set of quotes from top regulators. I'm going to go back to the maestro, Alan Greenspan, and to Mervyn King, who just recently wrote a book. I can, you know, I love to read their wonderful books. So, and then I'll conclude. So this is my plan, okay? So here is the wild world. You know, the world is changing. We're getting new leaders. And here is Beppe, you know. So I'm not going to sing this song of Cat Stevens. But if you want to leave me, take good care. Hope you have a lot of nice things to wear. But then a lot of nice things turn out bad out there. Oh, baby, baby, it's a wild world. Yeah, a wonderful song. I think that's today's situation. So let's start with Mervyn, okay? Our friend just finished a book, huh? Age of Alchemy, The End of Alchemy. Trust is the ingredient that makes a market economy work. How could we drive or even buy and sell unless we trusted other people? Everyday life would be impossible without trust. We give our credit card details to strangers, eat in restaurants we've never visited before. Of course, trust is supplemented by regulation. I think this is a very important thing. Of course, if we could make everything safe, that would be wonderful. But, you know, it's just a component. So, in a sense, we're like policemen, right? I mean, often we give fines, sometimes just a warning, you know, sometimes, and of course, you are all very friendly policemen. You just, you know, direct people to where they're supposed to go. But this government meddling, quote unquote, of course, has a long history in, I mean, if I retreat to my academic ivory tower, then, of course, if I were in the law school, I would appeal to legal realism and I would say Hugo Munsterbeck, you know, William James, John Dewey, Carl Llewellyn. These are sort of American. I'm sorry, I'm speaking on the American side here. But this is the background. These are the people who brought psychology and law together and said law would be better if it was more informed by behavioral science. That's an idea that's been out there for a while. And I assume that many of you are very much, you know, are nudgers, are influenced by my friend Dick Thaler and Cass Sunstein. The idea is to promote the common good in supposedly some pragmatic way. I think a lot of pragmatism, you know, we'll try this, we'll try that. But of course, ideally, making use, well, of some true understanding, as I say. Now, of course, we can't wait forever, otherwise we're never going to do anything. But if we try too many things that don't work, people will notice that too. So and you know, sort of one halfway position is this libertarian paternalism. We help people. We say, you know, we're going to set it up so it's friendly for you, but you can overrule it, perhaps. Cass Sunstein likes to talk about costs and benefits of regulatory measures. In how far that is really possible, I would question. I think in the end, it's just a lot of political judgment. Okay, so you see, they're very friendly, these policemen. Okay, here they're just checking how fast you drive. Okay, so let's look at a top regulator, the maestro, for the longest time, the closest thing to God, for the very long time on this earth. So we can see how much insight the maestro has. And we can do that easily by studying his two books, the one he wrote in 2007, right before the crisis, The Age of Turbulence, and then comparing that with The Map and the Territory, maybe you should have called it like Rousseau, Confessions, in 2013, you know, after the crisis. So I'm just going to go to some quotes from a friend I very much respect, of course. Don't misunderstand me, but just, okay. Remember, the theme is humility over confidence, etc. So here he is. The marketplace itself, in fact, regulates through what is known as counterparty surveillance. That was the view of 2007. As first a bank director at J.P. Morgan, and then a bank regulator for 18 years, I was acutely aware of how much better situated and staffed banks were to understand what other banks and hedge funds were doing, as compared with the by-the-book regulation done by government financial regulatory agencies. So that was his starting point. I mean, this type of self-regulation I would frankly call no regulation. I mean, it's simply saying people will hopefully look out for themselves. That's what's called counterparty surveillance. You know, on the street, you walk by somebody, you look at them, you say, oh, be careful. Okay, so. But of course, there's more. Regulation cannot substitute for individual integrity, he says. This is actually in a part of the book where he discusses how could he run so many regulatory agencies while being so skeptical himself of regulation. He says regulation cannot substitute for individual integrity. Any form of government guarantees lessens the needs of financial counterparties to earn a reputation. Here is an additional argument for honest dealings. The market value of reputation is pervasive throughout all professions. So this is another argument against. All right, so you see, he's getting argumentative, okay? And, okay, so now here is a good one, okay? So this is Allen in 2005. That's fairly late, okay? The financial services sector has been dramatically transformed. Technology has enabled creditors to achieve significant efficiencies. Where once more marginal applicants would simply have been denied credit, lenders are now able to quite efficiently judge the risk posed by individual applicants and to price that risk appropriately. These improvements have led to rapid growth in subprime mortgage lending. Man, what a victory. How smart we're getting, isn't it? I mean, it's unbelievable. But you have to keep in mind who this is, right? Okay, now here, still in the age of turbulence, regrettably, every time a hedge fund's problems makes the news, political pressure to regulate the industry mounts. Any government restrictions would curtail the risk-taking that is integral to the contribution of hedge funds to the global economy. Why do we wish to inhibit the pollinating bees of Wall Street? So, look, I'm sorry, I'm sort of putting all of this in perspective a bit, you know, playfulness. So, yeah, he's sweating, of course, I understand. So here he is in 2008 in the Financial Times. Here is the famous line. He has many famous lines, but this is one of his two or three most famous. Those of us who look to the self-interest of lending institutions, this is counterparty surveillance, okay? to protect shareholder equity or corporate governance have to be in a state of shocked disbelief. All right, I'm almost done here. So one more. But it's just, you know, just enjoy this show. Even with the breakdown of our sophisticated risk management models and the failures of the credit rating agencies, the financial system would likely have held together had the third bulwark against crisis, or regulatory system, functioned efficiently. But it too failed for many of the same reasons: an underappreciation of the risks faced by the financial system, and an increasing complexity that made effective oversight especially difficult. So anyway, here you see the evolution of one man, and I just want, you know, this was accepted at every point here. What he says, I think, is pretty much accepted as, you know, top judgment, right? I mean, the best possible achievable judgment. But we are dealing with millions of, you know, investors who apparently don't know whether they should or not invest in a negative yield bond, who cannot read the documents that are given of them, numeracy very low, etc., etc., etc. So let's bring in Merv again, Mervyn King. He says economics, and he's actually speaking about people like me, you know, the economic field has encouraged ways of thinking that made crises more probable. Economists have brought the problem upon themselves by pretending they can forecast. No one can easily predict an unknowable future, and economists are no exception. See, this is, you know, we ought to be careful. I'm not, you know, I'm arguing, of course, for research. I've spent 35 years of my life doing nothing but research. But I think we have to be careful in what we say and how we interfere in people's lives, because they might get annoyed with us if it doesn't work, you know. I mean, what do people know about regulation? Well, they know when they go to an airport. It's difficult. You have to stand there forever. What does it really do? That belt of mine, is that going to endanger anybody? It surely employs a lot of people. Yeah. You know, all of that, that's what comes to their mind. We have to be careful in what we do. So let me quote my dear friend Danny Kahneman. And he says what I want to say, simple message. He says, overconfidence is built so deeply into the structure of the mind that you couldn't change it without many other things. You know, he had an interview with The Guardian in 2015, and they asked him, of all of these biases you've described in judgment and choice, if you could just do away with one of them, what would you do away with? That's when he said this. He said, overconfidence. It's built so deeply into us, it's difficult to get rid of that, you know, wishful thinking. Of course, we want to make the world better around us. I know, and certainly many of you, all of you, want to do that, but we have to be careful. So now, there is, of course, the opposing view. Let me speak in your favor for a moment and bring in Monsieur Balladur when he was prime minister under Chirac. And he says, what is a market? It's the law of the jungle, the law of nature. And what is civilization? It's the struggle against nature. So this is quite an amazing statement, of course. So let us talk on the side of civilization. And we're all on the side of civilization. Let's think about that. And there is Cass. Eh? So Cass Sunstein, I already mentioned legal realism. I would say he's the most modern-day representation of this point of view. You know, Cass writes a lot of books. In fact, you should check that on your phone. So many books, it might overload the system. My friend Dick Thaler jokes that Cass thinks with his fingers because he writes so much. So, but he has endless ideas, frankly. And of course, he was located in the White House for a number of years. And a lot of what we see also here, you could say, is in a way the product of his thinking and, you know, as it has spread around the world. And of course, again, it goes way beyond financial regulation in the sense of investor protection and so forth. When we look at our central bankers, they're in despair, of course, today, with monetary policy tapped out, fiscal policy tapped out. They really don't know what to do anymore. You know, so they just, you know, their hero is, of course, Bernanke. You see his picture on the wall, the great improviser. You know, endless ideas. And you can see Janet is explaining to Mario, a very good student, Mario, a very good student, how it works. And of course, they're doing it all over the world now. But it's not really clear where this is leading. And then there is Dodd-Frank, this ought to hold them. Of course, this is just a cartoon of earlier in the year, you know, because now there is movement in the U.S. even to do the little fence away. Don't forget that. Now there is movement even to do that little fence away. So this is Jonathan Haidt, you know, at New York University, and he's done recently this very interesting research on how people's worldviews and also their political leanings have such a big influence on the kind of scientific opinions that they defend. So he studies economists and asks them questions like, on the whole, do you think that, let's say, our economic system, capitalism, is liberating? Or do you think that on the whole it is oppressive, more on the left Marxist side of looking at things? And then he shows that this basic outlook has a great influence on what these economists find in their quote-unquote scientific work when they write their papers. So the ones that are on the left are quite naturally Keynesians. The ones that are on the right, they would do away with, you know, with traffic lights. They're the ultimate conservatives. but I think this is something to keep in mind. Once again, the issue is not really more regulation or less regulation. It is smart regulation, informed regulation. And this is going to, this is difficult. This is difficult. So here is Mervyn King one final time. You know, he's also getting desperate, of course. He says, the danger in the assumption of behavioral economics that people are intrinsically irrational is that it leads to the view that government should intervene to correct biases in individual decisions and to nudge them towards optimal outcomes. I'm not sure that I share that view completely, of course. I mean, the danger, also the attractiveness in the assumption of behavioral economics is, as he says. But I do want to formulate a few thoughts now without photographs and without endless quotes on financial education. And I just want to say, ladies and gentlemen, it's going to be more difficult than you think, you know, to be successful at this. Now, what we want is to get from education to literacy and from literacy to some skills that supposedly push behavior in the right direction. And then, of course, we want financial well-being. We want, you know, people to live happily, okay? That's the chain. But what argues sort of against this? What do you have to keep in mind? First of all, the financial marketplace out there is incredibly innovative and dynamic. And new products, new ideas just come out continuously. And people who face financial decisions only face them episodically. You know, how many mortgages do you take out in your life? How many consumer credits do you really take? So this is already difficult. Actually, many people are not interested in financial education. You know, some research shows that the people who are interested in financial literacy and take courses and want to learn everything about it, are the people who already know a lot, already know more than others. Those are the ones who, you know, I guess some people are interested in football and then other people are interested in financial markets. My father is in that category, you know. I mean, the way he starts a conversation is, did you see what happened to Japanese interest rates? Something like that. In the same way that other people might say, did you see what happened to Arsenal? But it's difficult to get people interested in these things. As I've already said, with all these quotes, even the experts don't really know. They can't forecast the future. I mean, what do you make of these statements by Alan Greenspan? Let me remind you, I'm sorry to remind you, but the surprise, the crisis came as a surprise to everyone. I was just reading over the weekend, on the way here, I was in London briefly, Adair Turner, in his sort of quasi-autobiography, Between Death and the Devil, I was reading it over the weekend, he says that, you know, he was appointed as head of the Financial Services Authority in Britain the 8th of September 2008. He says he became aware that there might be a financial crisis or that things didn't look so good exactly 1 week before that. That was the first time. So the crisis was a surprise. Certainly the long recovery is a surprise. I mean, my economist friends have kept saying almost week after week, oh, it's turning around now, it's turning around now, it's turning around now. Okay. And then there is a Mr. Donald J. Trump. That also seems to have been a surprise to, you know, many people who are watching, you know, the world around us. So the world is full of surprise. Now, good decision making, a few words behaviorally, requires willpower. Many people miss that. Then, of course, it requires overcoming all these biases in judgment and choice. And then, of course, there is so much unpredictability in one's personal life. I mean, do you know how long you're going to live? Do you have a good idea of that? Do you know about unexpected medical expenses? As we know from the senator of Massachusetts, Elizabeth Warren, she wrote a book about that with her daughter. Most middle-class families in America get in trouble with unexpected medical expenses. How do you think they go bankrupt? That's the big cause. So most people are just short-term oriented, myopia, because it's very difficult to do much else. And all of that, you know, so I'm just explaining the difficulties, and all of that comes together with an investor sitting in front of an advisor or maybe, you know, a mortgage agent or so, in front of a lot of advertising, sales efforts, fiduciary rules that are perhaps there or not there, tremendous sales incentives, and somehow we are going to make the investor win. So I'm saying it's a difficult task. We have to be humble about this. We have to be careful about what we do, because otherwise behavioral science is going to be like a meteor, you know. It's seen very briefly, and then it disappears. So I end here with, you know, with a hopeful note from George Bernard Shaw. You see, a wise old man. And he said, the reasonable man adapts himself to the world. The unreasonable one, I belong to that group, persists in trying to adapt the world to himself. Therefore, all progress depends on the unreasonable man. I wish you a lot of success in doing this, but I want to, let me perhaps end with a quote of Confucius. You know, Confucius said that to know that you know what you know, and to know that you don't know what you don't know, that is true knowledge. But very few people have that. Thank you very much.